So the Texas Freshwater Fisheries Center was contacted by an angler, and that angler had caught this fish, which they had weighed on their scales at 14 pounds. When they showed up, it actually didn't come in over 13 pounds, so it couldn't be submitted as a sharelunker. But they did notice that it had a pit tag, and they were interested in who its mom and dad were. So we're going to look up this pit tag number, see if we have DNA isolated for this particular fish. And if we do, we're going to go down to the basement and grab that and work up a DNA profile to identify who its parents were. Here's OLB 601 to 700 here. Microsatellites, they're a relatively new marker. And I say relatively, when I say that I mean, you know, they've been around for the last couple of decades. But these are newer markers when you're talking about working with largemouth bass. And people started noticing these things when they were looking at organeller and nuclear DNA. So they would centrifuge these DNA components in a cesium chloride gradient. And when they do that, they get separate bands. The nuclear DNA would end up in one place, the organeller DNA in another. They started noticing additional bands showing up as well. And they thought, you know, what are these things? So they would extract those bands and examine the sequence. And what they were microsatellites, these repetitive sequences of DNA, a motif that repeats over and over again. But this motif is relatively small, 2 to 6 bases in length, but repeated, you know, a couple of times to tens of times, 20 times maybe. And these turned out to be really useful in population genetics because that structure made them inherently unstable. And that instability provided for a relatively high mutation rate that you could use for parentage analyses, looking at individuals and deriving the population of origin for that individual, and even species IDs. That structure, that repetitive structure, makes it so that when the polymerase is replicating during meiosis, replicating a template strand of DNA for the gametes, it's likely to slip and reanneal in a different location, at least more likely than in the rest of the genome. And because of that, you can get increases or decreases of a motif size in the microsatellite. That mutation is passed on to the offspring, and all of a sudden you have a unique marker that wasn't there before. When you compare these markers to allozymes and protein electrophoresis or even isoelectric focusing. When I started in 2004, the collection of tissue was somewhat sporadic, but since I've been here, we've collected tissue from every fish that's been donated to the sharelunker program. And we've also gone back and we've recovered archived tissues from older samples where we didn't necessarily have an official sample donated to Texas Parks and Wildlife, but somebody found a scale in their attic, or somebody had a mount on their wall at their house, or we had a fish behind glass in a museum or something like that, where we were able to collect tissue from those samples and add those to the database. These are real-time images coming off of the DNA sequencer. So this is our first locus here in our samples. These are those same samples loaded again, but spaced across the gel. And then our second locus is coming off up here at the top of the gel. And then the multiple bands you see are just size standards that are running alongside our samples. That way we can get a size and bases for each of the alleles we resolve. All right, so what we have here now is the raw image data from the DNA sequencer, the run just completed. We're looking at both the 700 and the 800 channel here simultaneously. And what we've done is we've imported that image into our bionumeric software so that we can define where each individual is on that raw image file. and then converted those raw images into a set of linked numbers and images for each individual. We can then take our unknown individual, fish 614, and compare it to our possible parental females, our possible maternal contributors, so Sharelunker 353 through Sharelunker 387, as well as the possible paternal contributors, fish number 481 through 518. And what we've done is we've compiled all of the genetic data we have for each of these individuals and identified which were possible parental pairs for OLB 614. And what we're going to show is the information at a specific locus, that's TPW 60, where you can see the paternal allele could only be derived from fish 518, and the maternal allele could only be derived from female 370, the female shown in red and the males shown in blue. So even looking at one locus, we can already discriminate among the possible parental pairs and narrow it down to that specific pair, with the only other option being that this individual is actually not the offspring of any pair in this comparison. But having looked at additional loci besides this locus, we can confidently say that fish 614 is in fact the offspring of Sharelunker 370 and male 518. Mystery solved.